Good evening, folks, and welcome to another edition of An Hour with Bob. Here we are on this beautiful March day. I mean, the weather, March weather, this is like May weather. Actually, Mayweather, there's a trivia question for you, folks. Who earned the most money for 2016 of any entertainer of any kind? It was Floyd Mayweather, right? $300 million he made. $300 million for a fight. Anyway, folks, people asking all the time, asking me, they're asking the political pundits, why is Trump doing so well? Well, there's an answer to that question, an easy answer to that question. Just go to any supermarket the first 3 or 4 days of each month and look for the person that's got a calculator and about 10 items in their shopping cart and ask them why. First of all, ask them if they're voting for Trump, and if they say they who they're voting for, in all likelihood they're voting for Trump. And the reason why is because you look around at some of the other people in the market who have carriages full, and they got stuff like frozen French toast and a frozen scallops and frozen shrimp and whatever else. They're the ones that are not paying for the food. They're the ones that got the so-called freebies, as it's called. They're what they call the takers. They're the people that have benefited for the last 8 years. And now the people that are paying the freight, paying the bills, they're the ones that I'm hearing are what we call the silent majority. And they're the ones that are pissed off in plain English. They're saying, we're paying the freight, we're grinding to make ends meet, working 40, 50 hours a week, and some of these people are not contributing, but they're getting all the bennies. And that is why I think Donald Trump is doing so well, coupled with the fact that if you recall the Congress, the Senate and the House, their rating is down below 20%. So they don't want a politician. I mean, I don't agree with Donald Trump. I don't particularly like Donald Trump. But the fact is that he is a non-politician, and right there gives him an edge with the what I call the silent majority. And they realize that if they don't do something soon, within the last 10 years, or should I say within the next 10 years, they're not going to be the majority anymore. And I think you can figure out why. So we're going to get into that a little more. And the reason I bring that up, by the way, is this is a very pivotal election day. This is a winner-take-all in Florida. It's a winner-take-all in Ohio. And I think it's the end of the line for Rubio, who, by the way, I had picked as my prediction was that he would win for the Republicans. So much for that. And Kasich, who I do like, if he doesn't win in Ohio, the party's over. It's going to be Trump. And I frankly don't care for, actually, I don't even know who I'm going to vote for President of the United States, because I really don't like any of the candidates. And Trump's idea of the wall, think about this. There are 2,000 miles across the Mexican-American border. 1,300 miles are covered by a fence, not a wall, a fence. Do you know there's 700 miles that don't have anything? Tell me what sense that makes. Why do we need a customs border enforcement group? Why do we have 23,000 of them? Why do we have a budget of $64 billion, not million, billion dollars for them, plus the 22 or 23,000 members of Homeland Security? Together, they make up 45,000 men and women that are protecting us against terrorists and bad people. Yet, the 700 miles of the Mexican border, American border, that have nothing across it. So either you got to have a wall, or you got to have a fence, or you got to have a border. You don't have a border. So if you're not going to have a border, why pay a 64, there's my dyslexia coming in play, $64.9 billion, not million, billion dollar budget for between Homeland Security and the border agents. That's what it costs you and me in taxes to pay to have a concert, and you got the whole front of the concert, all the entrances in the front guarded to the max. You're checking everybody out, and backpacks and searching them up and down and running the wands, but then the back doors are wide open. It makes no sense. Either you do one or the other. And that's my story, folks. Well, that's enough for me for tonight, because I want to see what happens after this election, this winner-take-all in Florida and in Ohio. But without further ado, I got to bring on a longtime friend of mine. We go, a long time is right. And when I ever found out how long he's been into the karate business, I was absolutely amazed, astonished. 10th degree black belt, good friend, and the creator of the Ocean State Grand Nationals. And I'm amazed also to find out how many years he's been doing this. Don Rodrigues, how you doing, Don?
Very good, Bob. How are you?
How do you like my tirade?
Listen, I like it.
Yeah?
I do.
We got to throw it out there sometime.
Absolutely.
You know? I look at the people they're saying about Trump, like him or not, he has a right to be able to speak. He has a right to say what he wants to say. Yet these people are disrupting the heck out of him and trying to make a mess out of it. And if it went the other way, there'd be people calling those people something else.
But you know what they're doing doesn't make any sense. You know, it really doesn't make any sense. They're causing these riots to happen and so forth. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like they're going to make a difference? Is that really going to make a difference?
It right,
really
isn't. Right.
You know.
Well,
what I mean?
They're hoping he messes up badly.
I understand.
They're hoping he reacts.
Listen,
terribly.
Some of the things he says make sense, and of course, some of the things he says that almost scare people.
Well, the other thing's bad about what it's how he says it.
I understand that.
I mean, he's not a politician.
Right.
He's not but he's off the charts with some of the stuff.
He is, and at the same time, a lot of people like him. You know.
Apparently. Well, now they say he's over 50%. You know, they had been saying he hit his ceiling at 30%, 32%, 35%. Now they're saying his ceiling's over 50%, meaning 50% of the population would vote for him no matter what.
Yeah.
And if that's the case.
Well, you know what? I think the general public has lost faith in politicians.
They've had it.
You know,
they really have had it.
Made constant promises that can't make,
right.
You know what I mean? Just to get elected. You don't
right.
say something, just get elected, but that's what they do all the time. You know what I mean? So, you know, it's really hard to trust any of them. It really is. And you made a good point the other day, just a little while ago, you said, I really don't like any of them. You know
right.
what I mean? You know, so you're picking the best of all evils, so to speak.
Yeah,
you know what
yeah
I
mean? The lesser of all evils,
yeah,
the lesser
of
any of
right.
any of the evils.
That's
exactly,
right.
exactly.
That's right. Right. So,
I mean, you look at some of them. Hillary, you know, she's got her problem. She really has her problem.
She really does. She really does. You know, so it's a tough decision to make. It really is. It's going to be hard for the American people to make a decision. I you know what? Trump's name is out there.
Yes.
Know?
Yeah.
You know, so gonna have to see what happens. Hopefully God's watching us all and we'll take care of the right thing. Let's see what happens.
Well, what's happened with the Ocean State Grand National? By the way, how many years, Don?
This is our 36th year.
36 years
36
you've been
years.
Doing the Ocean State Grand
you
National.
You know, Bob, I got to tell you, 36 years ago we started the karate tournament and we had 150 people there, you know?
Yep.
And, you know, it was a small karate tournament. It was at Warwick Vets High School, you know,
right.
the gym over there.
Yep.
And I was sweating bullets because I had a budget going on. And I was worried about losing money, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But, you know, we had 150 competitors show up. I just had 23 divisions. And
wow.
Now here we are, you know, over 1,000 competitors, and we have 350 divisions, and we got,
wow.
you know, a dozen countries that have made commitments to come in, and over 30 states that are going to be represented. And so, the tournament's really taken a plus where we have to run it 3 days now.
Yeah. Oh, you know? Yeah. Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
Yeah.
And plus, you have some. You over the years, you've had some big names.
I've had the biggest names you can have.
Exactly.
And, you know, Chuck Norris has been
right?
here, and Don Wilson, and Bill Superfoot Wallace.
Superfoot.
Yeah. And this year we have Cynthia Ruthrock, the Lady Dragon, they call her, and she's done over 30 films, and. In the martial art world, she's a legend.
Right.
Black Belt Hall of Famer. And she'll be there Saturday night. Good friend. She's been here a couple of times, you know. And her and Christine did a film together. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
They both did a...
Let me tell people that Christine Bannon Rodrigues, your wife.
Yeah.
She's been doing karate how long?
She's been in... she started in 1982. So...
34 years.
Yeah. 34 years.
I think, if I'm right.
No. Yeah, yeah.
Am I right? 34
yeah.
years?
34 years, yeah.
That's pretty quick, huh? That's not bad, huh?
Yeah. I mean, actually, I'm sorry. She started in 1980, so she's been in for 36 years. 36 years.
Wow.
First year she came, when I saw
her.
How
old was she?
She was 13.
Wow, my gosh.
13 years old when she started with me. Yeah. And, you know, and it's a person that if somebody had come in at the time and said, you know, who do you think your best student's going to be? She wouldn't have been on my top 10 list.
Really?
No, she wouldn't have been. But
does she know that?
Oh, yeah, I tell it all the time.
You tell her.
But
tell
you know
all
what?
The time.
She ended up.
She worked at it, is what she did.
Incredibly. And she was, her desire was to be the best woman competitor of all time.
Right.
And
she's done a pretty good job.
She really has. I mean, the two names that pop up right away on anybody's chart is Christine Bannon Rodrigues and Cynthia Rothrock. Those are the two.
Right,
you know what
right,
I mean?
Right.
So they're both going to be there Saturday night, you know.
Now, can Cynthia do the thing your wife does?
You know, Cynthia is extremely good at doing forms and weapons. She never fought that much in competition,
right.
You know what I mean? Great actor, though. She's a great actor, and she's really good in films, and she's just such a great person. Christine's thing in competition, even though she was good in forms and really good in weapons, it was her fighting. She excelled in fighting,
yep.
You know what I mean? And that's because our school was a fighting school,
yes,
you know what
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah.
And
she could take out her aggressions on her competitor rather than you.
Well, yeah, exactly, right? Exactly, you know? Yeah, so, you know, she was very determined. She's done things that no one's ever done. She's the only person, man or woman, to win 3 gold medals at the World Championships.
Wow.
Fighting forms and weapons, and she did it twice. No
really?
One's ever done it once. She's
right.
done it
she's
twice.
She's done it twice.
She did it in 91 and 93.
And she's what, a 9-time world champion?
She is a 9-time WACA world champion, yeah.
Wow.
More than anybody. So, yeah, so we're proud of her accomplishments. And, you know, it was her determination to be the best, you know. It really was, you know. And, of course, you know, all those years of her kicking people in the head and stuff took its toll. As we know, she just had double hip surgery
done. That's right.
Done.
Yeah, just a couple months
ago.
Yeah,
right? Well, actually six weeks ago, she had double hip surgery done. And but just like everybody knew, she's already walking around and she's driving. She's teaching classes.
Lucky her, unlike me.
As we're talking right now, she's teaching class. You know what I
wow.
mean? Yeah. So
6 weeks out.
6 weeks out. She's doing terrific.
Both. She had them both at the same
both
time.
Both hips done at the same time. Yep.
Wow.
They had her walking that day.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it's amazing.
Well, they had me walking that day.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Then they had me back in for surgery.
Oh, I know. It's incredible story there, you know. But so far it's been good. It's
yeah.
Been good, yeah.
Now, is she going to be back to teaching again?
Or? She's teaching right now.
Oh, she's teaching now, but is she going to be back? No, she's not going to be back in competition.
Nah, no. You know what? Listen, a competitor's always a competitor, but you know what I'm saying? She sees people, she says, I think I might put the clothes back on, you know what I mean?
Really?
If somebody
yeah.
ticks her off, you know? But, and believe
and she's
me.
She's in unbelievable shape.
Let me tell you something. She hasn't missed anything, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
6 months from now, Bill Wallace, of course, a very good friend of ours, he's had both hips done. And, you know, 6 months from now, she'll be back the way she was before, which could kick straight up in the air, you know what
right.
I mean? And
right.
But, you know what? I got to tell you that she's a phenomenal athlete. And in our sport, her name is really something. Because she went on to other things, Bob. She became a product designer for
right.
Macho. She actually designed a special chest protector and a special face mask that are actually mandatory to wear at tournaments now for kids.
Oh, no kidding.
17 and under has to have a face shield and has to have a chest protector. It's mandatory.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, and she designed the universal face mask where it can go over any helmet. You know what I mean?
Oh, wow.
And it says CBR right on it, on the chest protector.
Yeah, Christine Bannon Rodrigues.
Exactly,
yeah.
You know. So she's a product designer now. She's been a consultant for Macho for over 20 years, you know. And now she's, you know, dabbling dairy.
Plus she was in the movies.
She's done a lot of films, yeah. Yeah. And actually, we got a film crew going to be at the Ocean State that wants to film a trailer that they want to do. And it's going to actually feature Christine and on how she competed and won those 3 gold medals that we're talking about.
Right.
They have interest in it, you know what I mean? So there'll be a film crew there on Saturday during the day and at night to film some of the stuff, you know?
Wow.
Yeah, yeah. So it's going to be a special day. It's going to be a special night, you know?
All right, well, listen, special day, special night. We got a special guest here. All the way from north of Boston, huh?
That's right, yeah.
You came from Beverly today?
I did today, yeah.
You drove from Beverly today, huh?
Well, yeah, or Salem, really, today. But
oh, from Salem.
But they're really near each other.
Sean, I got to understand the name of this band. I mean, I love the name. You know, when you play with a band,
yeah.
you play as, or is, when you play solo, you use your name or you use a band thing?
I do both, depending on the show.
So it's Sean McKenna, was it McKenna?
Yeah, that's my name. There's another artist named Sean McKenna, too. That's why I go by the other name.
The other name is Lay Low Moon?
That's right, yeah.
Now, what was that, a psychedelic trip you were on when you came up
close
with that name?
I like to keep it clean, you know.
You keep it clean?
I don't do that stuff.
No.
No. It's actually from a song by a singer named Beck.
And yeah, I know who Beck is. You think I'm that old that I don't know who Beck is?
Well, I don't know.
Beck is one of the two people that the guy I can't stand ridiculed after he won a Grammy.
Oh yeah.
Right.
Oh yeah,
the guy I'm talking about, Kanye West.
Kanye? Yeah.
Kanye West grabbed the Grammy off him, saying you don't deserve it.
Oh, that's right.
It belongs.
Yep.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, he did the same thing he did to what's her name there?
Taylor Swift, maybe.
Huh?
Was it Taylor Swift?
Taylor Swift. He did the same thing. Went up on the stage and right? He went up on the stage to grab the mic or grab the award that Beck won. Beck's from England, right?
No, he's from the United States.
Oh, is he?
He's from like California, I think.
Oh, I thought he was from England or something.
No.
No? Well, he's the one that won the award. Beck.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And, Kanye West went up and grabbed the award. Same thing. That was last year, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Not this year.
Yeah, like a year ago.
A year ago. Saying it should have went to Beyonce again. Mm-hmm. Same thing. I mean, the guy's a piece of work.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. They should bomb.
No respect.
Yeah, he has absolutely no respect. He has no class at all. None whatsoever.
No.
But so I know who Beck is. Let's get to that point.
Yeah,
right?
So there's lyrics from a Beck song that I used for the name of the band, basically. So I got it from there.
But you write your own material.
I do.
But
yeah.
You had to get somebody else's lyrics to come up with your name of your...
Well, I mean, people come up with band names all sorts of ways.
I know they do. That's why I love to ask. I love to hear their reasoning.
Yeah.
You know, I got some of the weirdest reasons, and I was joking when I said, of course, the psychedelic reality.
Sure.
That's the 60s stuff.
Sure.
60s and 70s stuff.
Definitely. Yeah.
All right, what kind of stuff do you do? What do you call it? Indo?
Or indie folk, I guess.
Indie what?
Indie folk, I guess.
Indie folk.
Yeah.
Is that like, and you're not talking about Indian or Indianapolis. What kind of folk? What is
like
indie folk?
Like indie is short for like independent, I guess. Like our indie music, you know, and then... Folk, you know, folk music, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So that's kind of the kind of music I play, with some pop hooks, I guess, you know, in there.
Okay. Well, let's hear what you got for us.
Sure. This is a song called "Saltwater Taffy," I guess, or I know so, but. If I showed you where I am, and if I told you where I stand, here with me, where I stand, here with me, where I am, be with me, Marie. I remember the day. Blue dress holding me. I remember the day. So what a taffy meant for you. And I remembered you the way you were with me. If I showed you where I am. If I told you where I stand.
If I showed you where I am, if I told you where I stand, you're with me.
Thank you.
John McKenna.
Thank you. Thank you.
Nice job. Lay Low Moon.
That's right.
Lay Low Moon. We'll be back with Lay Low Moon in a few more minutes after we talk a little more to my good friend Don Rodrigues. We go back a long time, Don.
Sure do.
I was in my attic looking for an old tape for John Flanagan, wanted to find a tape. I don't know why. Why did you ask John why he wanted? He wants me to find the tape of Salty Brine. It was the last major interview, I think, or the last interview he did was here. And it was a very emotional interview. He did something, a lot of people didn't know that Salty Brine had an artificial leg. And the people that didn't know, most of them didn't know how he got his artificial leg. I did know. And he asked me, and it was funny because Tony Petracca was here. We had the desk, low desk, and he said to me, he says, "Do you mind if I do something I've always wanted to do? Do you mind if I do it, you know, getting up in years?" He says, "I always wanted to do this." I said, "Go right ahead, Salty, do what you want." He takes his leg off, he puts it right on the desk. Tony Petracca is like, and I said, "Oh, what's going on?" He says, "I always wanted to do that because when I was a kid, kids were so mean to him. He was 11 years old and he was hopping trains." By the way, I did that too when I was a kid. And I don't recommend that kids to do that, hopping trains. But we used to, the freight trains come through Pawtucket, right near what we used to call the Six Bridges. And we used to run up as they were taking off and jump on them and take a ride, get off a few miles later. And he did with his friends and he missed and he fell and he went underneath the,
wow.
And they're not tires, they're
steel
rollers, and right under there, cut his leg right off. Wow. And back in the day, he obviously was an older man, and they just had a leather strap with a peg, like a peg leg. And he said when he got home from school, he'd take the leg off, and you know, it was all raw, the meat was, you know, just ripped apart from the peg leg, plus the fact they were calling him peg leg in school. And he always wanted to talk about that, and he did on the show. So John wants to revive that show, I guess, because we recently revived the Buddy Cianci show that he was on here 20 years and 6 months before he died.
Oh, wow.
20 years ago. And he was one of the very few people I've interviewed with just him. Nobody else, no music, nobody else, just him. And we replayed that a few weeks back, right after he died.
No kidding.
So don't you think, in the process of looking for it, Don Rodrigues, I came across an old fighter of yours. And one of the best I've ever seen. You know who I'm talking about, right?
I do.
Manson Gibson. Nice, one of the nice from Chicago, right?
Chicago.
I remember going with him to Hungary. And I also went with him to Morocco, right? To fight.
Yeah, yeah.
He was the toughest guy. Was he middleweight?
Yeah.
He was the toughest fighter I ever seen in my life.
Yeah.
That guy, his reverse back.
Oh, he was phenomenal athlete, and he used to fight up in weight too. He'd fight a light heavyweight, even though he was a middleweight. You know what I mean? And very successful. He's fought in other countries, Japan. He was very, very, very popular in Japan.
Right,
Mason Gibson. You know what I mean? But really, really, and a great guy too.
Oh, yeah, really very low key, very quiet. He wouldn't say the SHIT if he had a mouthful.
Yeah, exactly.
But in the ring, he was an animal.
Well, you know what? That competitiveness in him, you know. But really a nice guy, awesome fighter. Really
did anybody ever beat him?
You know what?
I think his first fight or something?
Yeah, he had a couple of defeats.
Early on.
Later, I think he hung around a little bit and he lost towards the end once.
Did he?
Yeah, but he was absolutely one of the best fighters that's ever fought in the ring, you know. Really. And a lot of people don't recall him,
Right.
You know what I mean?
Well, because Americans didn't appreciate kickboxing back then.
No.
So Europeans and the Asians, my God.
Big time.
I mean, we were at one fight. It was 29,000 people at the fight.
Yeah, yeah. That's out in other countries, it's huge. You know what I mean? And he was a rock star out there.
Oh, yeah.
He really was.
Yeah.
Especially in Japan, they loved him out there, you know. Really did.
Now, you, like you said, you have people coming from other several other countries coming to this, right?
Yeah. We actually have Zsolt Meredi from Budapest, Hungary. He'll be here.
I've been there. Budapest, Hungary.
Zsolt won my tournament 2 years ago. He was my grand champion here. And last year, he fought for the grand championship, but one of my other guys, Justin Ortiz, beat him for the grand championship.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so Zsolt and this guy, Laszlo Gombos, they're both on my Paul Mitchell team from Hungary, you know what I mean?
Right.
So they're on the team. So they were fighting each other, they're teammates, but they still fight hard. And Zsolt just won the Irish Open, which is the biggest tournament in Europe, 2 weeks ago. He won the Irish Open for the second year in a row.
Wow.
Yeah, so Zsolt Meredi is going to be here, and he's going to be fighting. And we've got a lot of people, a lot of world champions, a lot of stars that are coming out. You know, Tyler Weaver, who also performed in Ireland back in November, is the first competitor to get a perfect score in forms.
Wow.
Seven judges gave him a 10, the first time it's ever been done.
Wow.
International competition, because there's always Russians or somebody that just
they
will not
give
an American.
They won't give a 10. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Unless it's their fighter.
He just did such a phenomenal job that everybody gave him a 10. There was three Russian judges on that panel, and all three of them gave him a 10.
Wow. That's saying something.
So Tyler will be here, and we got a lot of great competitors coming. Really, really.
Now, this is going to be again in Warwick, is it?
Yeah, it's going to be at the Crown Plaza Hotel.
Friday, Saturday, and Sunday,
Friday, Saturday.
8th, 9th, and 10th.
Exactly. 8th, 9th,
of
and
April.
10th. And the 9th, we'll have the Saturday Spectacular with all the black belts
right,
and stuff.
Right.
On Friday night, we're actually doing a night show too, but it's featuring all the underbelts. So everybody,
that's cool.
All the kids and under black belts, they're going to have their night, you know what I mean, on Friday night. And then Saturday we have the Black Belt Spectacular, you know what I mean? On Sunday, then we get all the kids to compete on Sunday. That way the instructors can watch their kids compete.
Right.
And on Saturday, all the kids can watch their instructors compete.
That's smart. Well, you've been doing it so long, you figure it out, right?
So black belts compete on Saturday, the under belts compete on Sunday. You know, it's a really good show, and we're really excited about it. Like I said, we got Cynthia Rothrock coming in, and she's a terrific person. And you know what? I got to tell you that it takes a lot to run one of these things. It really does.
Oh, of course it does. How many competitors?
Well, we get about 1,000 competitors.
Competitors.
Yeah, yeah. You know, and on some years when I've had Chuck Norris in here, we had 1,500 competitors because everyone wants to see Chuck.
Sure.
You know? We had him in twice, Chuck, you know, back in 2000.
I got pictures. My Zachary's got pictures with Chuck Norris.
2001, 2005, he was here. And so it's been good. The tournament's been really good, you know what I mean? So we have it already booked out for 2019. I got the dates already set.
You fill that place, right?
Yeah.
Or you get all the rooms in that place.
Yeah, the whole hotel is booked by us. And we have seven other hotels that we filter into. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, they love you down there.
Oh, yeah, yeah. The city and the city gets behind us. The city of Warwick backs us 100%. And, you know, of course, we got sponsors that help us out and stuff.
Sure.
You know what I mean? So without having no sponsors, you just can't run these events. You know, it's an enormous amount of work and stuff. And, you know, the Crown Plaza has been terrific with us. You know what I mean? And we've had some local businesses help us out. The Tori Andreozzi Foundation.
Oh, my God, you know, yeah.
They've been a big part of us, you know what I mean? They really have. And now we got Ocean State Collision that's been on board with us. And you know what? You know, Macho Martial Arts, we got Century Martial Arts, and Oriental Gateway. All of these are competing companies,
right?
You know, but they all support our tournament.
Which is interesting.
Yeah.
Which is interesting.
But they all support our tournament.
Especially when you, and should be noted, folks, Don Rodrigues Karate is based in Warwick, Rhode Island.
Yes.
And what's the name of it?
Oh, it's Commerce Drive.
Commerce Drive, which is right off Airport Road. Yep. You get on Airport Road. There's a red light right there. Take a left down the down Commerce Drive.
Yep.
You've been there since you moved from Airport Plaza.
Airport Plaza, yeah. We've been there actually. We're in our 18th year there.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I remember when you moved.
Well, it's a big facility. It's 8,000 square feet.
And it's off the beat. You know, it's not like right on the main drag where you got to worry about parking or whatever.
No, we got
a lot of places to park.
You know, it's a great facility. We got 4 different dojos, a weight room. I mean, it's really nice. And we have multiple classes going on at the same time. My wife will be teaching kickboxing. I'll be teaching a karate class. We'll be teaching a kids class in the other room. So, you know,
My God. What about those little ones?
Remember those?
I told you. I want to get those little, redhead. Remember the little redhead?
Oh, yeah. Well, that little redhead right now is in his mid-20s, just so you know.
Cut it out.
I'm just telling you, you know.
Oh, my God.
In his mid-20s.
You've had some adorable kids, four, five years old.
I mean, those kids were terrific, you know. But they've all grown up. They're all adults now.
That's unbelievable.
Yeah.
That really is unbelievable.
You know what? They've, and some of them, I got their kids taking karate.
I'll bet.
You know what I mean?
I'll bet.
Yeah.
So karate, what does karate do for a kid? Explain to people what karate does for a kid.
Well, it gives kids, depending on the kid itself, you know what I mean? Some kids that are very shy, it gives them a lot of confidence. It's not just about kicking and punching and stuff. When someone goes into the martial arts for the first time, that could be the very first time they've ever accomplished anything by just getting a stripe on their belt.
Right.
At 3 or 4 years old, it's an accomplishment. It's the first thing they have accomplished anything in their life, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And then their short life.
You know what I mean? Exactly. Now what happens is they start realizing that, wow, if I work hard, I can get another stripe and another stripe. So it's these short-term goals leading up to a long-term goal that teaches them how to achieve. And that's what martial arts does. Teaches them how to achieve. It gives them confidence in what they can do.
But it
they approach everything like they approach school in a different way.
Right.
They approach life in a different way. You know what I mean? It's you know, I want to tell you something, Bob. When I was coming up in martial arts, in my mid-20s, I honestly thought that I was invincible. There wasn't anything I couldn't do.
Yeah.
I'm telling
Bruce
you.
Bruce Lee thought he was invincible,
I'm telling
too.
You, everything, I approached everything the same way.
Right.
There's nothing I can't do. I can accomplish anything.
Right.
And then something tragic happened to me. My father died. And I'm saying, how come I can't do anything about this? And I felt very vulnerable at that time. Prior to that, there wasn't anything. And that's what martial arts did for me.
Right.
You know what I mean? It really did. Gave me so much confidence of what I can do and so forth. And now what I really love doing is teach people how to be the same way.
Right.
You know what I mean?
And your two boys, your two kids.
My kids are doing terrific.
How old is Dante?
Dante's 18. He's a freshman at URI. And he won the world championship in Waco last year in Italy.
In Italy?
Yeah, yeah. So now I've had my three of my four, well, five actually. But, you know, Christine, of course, was a 9-time world champion. My son, Christopher, won the world championship in Portugal in 99.
Wow.
Dante just won the world championship in 2015 in Italy.
Wow.
You know, and I got my youngest one, Nico. He's taking a little break from it.
How old is he, 15?
Nico's 14 years old right
14.
Now.
I was close.
He's going to be 15 in June. But he's been doing karate since he was 3 years old.
Right.
So we're giving him a little break from it right now. But he's a really good fighter, and I know he's going to come back, and he's going to be one of those people that's going to be hard to deal with. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But everything's good. Everything's really good. Yeah.
Well, that's amazing.
Well, a family that kicks together sticks together.
You've been together. You've been with Christine how long?
Well, me and Christine celebrated our 25th anniversary last year.
That's unbelievable.
Last November.
That is unbelievable.
Know? So, you know, I've been fortunate. You know what I mean?
I really
have been fortunate. And I'm not done accomplishing things.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I really am not.
Yeah.
You know,
you've worked hard. You worked hard putting this together. I know that.
Well, yeah. And this is our little baby here. You know, we've cultured it. You know, and now it's one of the most respected tournaments in the country.
That's nice.
We're on the NASCA Tour.
Right.
North American Sport Karate Association. And they actually have 15 tournaments nationwide.
Right.
Now, the tournament coming up is in Philadelphia next week. And then it's my tournament in Rhode Island. Then we got Quebec 2 weeks later. Then we have down in Florida 2 weeks after that. Then, you know, so it goes all over the country. California, Chicago, New York. I mean, it's a tour, North American Sport Karate Tour. And our tournament is the Rhode Island stop.
And the Paul Mitchell sponsorship has been going on how long, the team sponsorship?
We'll be starting our 29th year.
That's unbelievable.
At this tournament.
That is unbelievable.
John Paul DeGioia, who is the owner and CEO of Paul Mitchell Hair Products.
Yep.
29 years ago, we started this karate team, and we've had it going since. Now,
wow.
It's been amazing because we've had about 110 people on that team. But these Hollywood motion pictures now,
yep.
Almost all of the action films that you see there are our guys. John Valera is the top stunt person in Hollywood. He was on our team. He won my tournament.
How cool is that?
Ming Lu is Lucy Liu's stunt double in all those movies that she's done. You know what I mean? So Mike Chat was a Power Ranger. You know what I mean?
And and your wife was the stunt double for Alyssa Silverstone.
Yeah, that's right. She was Batgirl. You know what I mean? In Batman and Robin. You know what I mean? And she was Hillary Swank. Stunt double in that Karate Kid movie. You know what I mean?
Wow.
And so it's been really fascinating. Matt Emick, who's going to be there this year, he was Shredder in last year's Ninja Turtle movie. Okay, so a lot of the people that are in films in doing the stuff in there are all from the Paul Mitchell team.
That's,
you know,
unbelievable.
What I mean? Now next year will be 30 years, so we're going to have like an alumni dinner. We're going to have everybody.
Oh, that'd be cool.
Yeah, we're
going
to have that, and I believe we have a shot at getting John Paul to come in for it. You know what I mean?
So, from Paul Mitchell.
Oh yeah. Wow. He is somebody else because he's just such an incredible guy. When I first met him, 29 years ago. Here we are with a guy that's a multimillionaire, you know what I mean? And he looked at our proposal, he said, hey, let's give it a shot, you know what I mean? He says, I'll tell you something. He goes, if you treat this sponsorship right, you'll have it for a long time.
I guess he was right.
I shook his hand.
On
I said,
a handshake.
I'm looking forward to a long-term relationship. That's what I said.
That's what
now,
I call
here
a long-term
are.
Relationship, 29 years later.
Here we are, 20, isn't that something? You know what I mean?
Well, listen, I got to let you go. I know you got to go back, but I want to first make it known that you left these tickets. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to have, you're going to look me up on my Facebook page, folks, Bob Venturini, or An Hour with Bob, one or the other. And you tell me why you should get a ticket to, what night is this?
This is going to be Saturday night.
The best night.
This is the big night.
These tickets are $25 a piece.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Get a hold of me on Facebook. Bob Venturini or An Hour with Bob or Bob's Big Adventure. I have 5 Facebook pages. Can you imagine that? And tell me why you should get a ticket. Oh, and maybe if you're really good, you might get 2 tickets to the event. How's
there
that?
There you go. There you go.
Don Rodrigues, always a pleasure. And thank you once again for your unbelievable support of our annual Toys for Tots.
It's one of my favorite times of the year, Bob. You know, just knowing that we can contribute and be a part of it is just phenomenal to me. It makes me feel special.
You know? Well, you're one of my original guys. You're one of my best sponsors over the years, supporters.
Always will be. I just want you to know that.
Well, I really appreciate it. You're the best.
Thank you.
Don Rodrigues, folks.
So yeah, here's another song for you.
And I don't know if I know me through and through and through and through again. And I don't know if I have the right to, but I believe in you, you do. So I'm going away. I'm not coming back until I'm better. I'm not sure that I'm through with you, and I don't think that I see through ya. So please just ask me to stay and tell me more about the weather, 'cause I don't know what it is I'm saying to me. And I don't know what it is I'm saying to myself, but the fact of the matter is that you may very well be all I need. And I don't have much more to say. 'Cause I've been bruised and I've been battered, and I don't know if I get through to you, but I just hope and I pray you follow through. That you follow through.
Thank you.
Sean McKenna.
That's right.
Huh?
Yes, yeah.
Now, where do you get your inspiration for these songs?
I just like my personal life, I guess.
Yeah? Mostly,
yeah.
You don't have any, my girl left me and she walked away and, you know, all that kind of stuff. Like
sometimes,
Huh?
Sometimes, yeah.
You do?
Yeah, yeah.
A little bit
of that.
All different things. Who do you like as an artist? Who inspires you as an artist?
So yeah, I guess Beck was a big one.
Beck, yeah. Yeah, but that's recent. Who else?
So I guess some other people, like it's a band called Big Star. They came from Memphis back in the 70s.
Wow, you got me on that one.
Yeah, they're pretty good. It's probably one of my other biggest influences as well as there's a guy from Wilco, Jeff Tweedy.
Jeff Tweedy. You know Jeff Tweedy? No.
Good stuff. You should check it out on the
Now, where are you playing next? You got something coming up.
That's right. I'm playing at a place called the Midway Cafe. It's in Jamaica Plain, Massachusetts, on the 22nd of March, which is it's coming Tuesday.
Oh, wow.
That's right.
And the biggest highlight of your career thus far?
Well, I guess I'd have to say it was being included on this compilation. That was the last song I just played was actually on this compilation. Called 100,000 Voices, which all the proceeds for went to a charity organization that supports mental health outreach for college students. And it's called Active Minds Incorporated.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So it's important stuff. I recommend looking into them.
Oh, that's cool. Everybody should have a charity or something or some kind of motivation that is not for money.
Yes. Yeah.
You know? That's good. Well, we'll get back to you soon.
Thank you.
Look who's here. Miss Rhode Island 2016, Theresa
Agonia.
Agonia.
Yes.
Agonia. That's Portuguese, isn't it?
It is Portuguese.
Portuguese, huh? A Portuguese girl originally from Central Falls.
Yes.
Right?
Currently live in Cumberland.
In Cumberland. Wow.
Yeah.
Now, I do understand that way back you're an early 20 girl, but
yes.
Before that, when you were young, you were in the Portuguese Miss team.
Miss Portugal, Rhode Island. Yeah, that was in 2007.
Yeah, but before that, I'm going back further. Was that the furthest one you went back?
Yeah.
It is.
I was 16 for my first pageant.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, and did you win a trip to Portugal?
I did. I was Miss Rhode Island, Miss Portugal, Rhode Island Junior, and then I was Miss Portugal, Rhode Island Senior, and I won a free trip to Portugal, which was great for me to go see some family.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a great opportunity.
Now, had you ever been there?
Yes, I've been going to Portugal since I was very young. I was baptized in Portugal when I was a few
Born
months
here,
old.
Born here, but baptized in
yes,
Portugal.
Yes, my godparents live in Portugal. They're retired. Part of their time is in France, and part of their time is in Portugal.
Now, what's the French connection there?
It's just close by. But my godparents, they only speak Portuguese and French. So I had to learn those languages to communicate with them.
Wow.
So, yeah.
And well, you make it sound like it's easy to learn two languages.
It's, you know, I think the earlier you start, the easier it is.
Oh, there's no doubt about that, yes.
I grew up in a bilingual home, speaking
right.
Portuguese with my parents. So Portuguese, you know, I speak Portuguese fluently. And then I took 6 years of French in school.
Well, I took 4 years of French in school, and I can't speak 10 words of French.
I'm conversational in French. I wouldn't go ahead and say that I'm fluent.
Right.
But I can get by. Yeah.
Well, that's
and
nice.
I speak some Spanish, too.
Well, I guess if you speak
it's so
Portuguese,
similar to Portuguese.
Right, or Italian, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You could pick up on that, too.
Yeah, Italian's a little more difficult for me, but I
really?
Find Spanish to be pretty easy.
Oh, I thought it would be the same or close.
No.
And by the way, I took 9 years of Latin.
Yeah.
I went to a Catholic school.
I bet if you were a lawyer, that would have really helped, because I heard studying Latin is very
right.
Connected to that.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
So what do you do? What do you do now? Wait a minute. I found out something about you. You graduated from my alma mater.
Roger Williams University?
That's right.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, when I went there, it was a college.
Yeah.
You were there from the starting class. Yeah. Hey, watch yourself. I was there from the, I think we were the second graduating class out of that school. In Bristol.
Yeah, yeah.
When it moved to Bristol. Because when I first started, it was in Providence, but I knew it was going to become a four-year school.
Yep.
And it was going to Bristol. It had just become a four-year school.
Yeah.
But it was moving to, they were building the campus when mm-hmm. I went to college there. And we had our first 2 years of classes in Providence, and I had one class in Rollo Jewelry on Pine Street. We had another class at All Saints Church, and another class at the Boy Scouts. So we always said if we flunked out of school, we could either work in a jewelry factory, or we could become a priest, or an altar boy, or we could be a a Cub Scout, a Boy Scout, or something.
That's a little bit of everything.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Rhode Island was really known for the industrial times that we had. You know, manufacturing was really big, so I'm sure that helped you at some point.
Well, by the way, do you know that Rhode Island used to be the jewelry capital of the
yeah.
entire world?
Yeah.
Yeah, there were jewelry finding companies. Yeah. When I grew
Providence
up as a
was
kid,
a big part of that.
Oh, huge.
Yeah.
No, they still call it the jewelry district
yeah.
over there. But when I was a kid, I used to hustle jewelry to make money, you know, among other things. Never drugs or anything like that, folks. But fireworks, but never drugs. But, you know, you had to grind. I grew up, my dad died when we were all young. So we had to hustle. We had to do whatever we had to do.
Yeah.
And I learned how to get connected with different jewelry manufacturers in the area.
Yeah.
And I used to buy the jewelry and then resell it Christmas time. I used to sell it to the teachers. Sell leather boots to the teachers, all kinds of stuff.
Anything Handyman.
You can buy. Go to Brockton, because Brockton used to be the capital of the country. Got ruined when they moved, they moved all these businesses, and to save money, these companies mm-hmm. just moved out. They moved to Thailand and Taiwan, and they moved to China and whatever else, and they took all the jobs away, because at one time, most of the suits in this country were made right in Fall River.
Yeah.
Most of the leather goods, boots and shoes especially, were made in Brockton.
Mm-hmm. Close by.
And they just moved everything out. So and of course that killed the manufacturing industry in this country.
Yeah, and so we're still left with a lot of factories.
Right.
But finding new uses for them, which is great. You know, you've seen so many new micro lofts or mixed use spaces pop up in communities like Central Falls and Providence and Pawtucket,
yeah.
Which is great to reuse that space because it's just an existing structure right now.
Well, in fact, they had, you ever watch that Shark Tank, the mm-hmm. series Shark Tank, where people go before them? Have you seen that Shark Tank? People go before them and they got an idea and they want help, they want financing or whatever.
Yeah.
Well, they had a company right on Mineral Spring Avenue, not far from me, in one of those redone mills, and they do peanuts. They roast peanuts.
Interesting.
And jars of peanuts over there.
Wow.
And there's also a brewery in there. In fact, there's at least two breweries in Pawtucket.
Yeah, they're popping up. A number of craft breweries in Pawtucket. They have a couple in Woonsocket now. They're popping up everywhere.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you graduated from Roger Williams with a degree in...
In media communications.
Communications.
Yeah.
And you want to be on TV?
No.
Then why?
I did communications... Well, for a couple of reasons. I actually grew up wanting to be an English teacher, and I changed my mind in 10th grade when I had an English class that I wasn't in favor of.
Was it a professor, the teacher?
No, I had a great teacher, someone who became my mentor throughout the next couple of years, but I just didn't like the content that I was studying, and I assumed that all English classes would be the same.
Oh.
So I actually asked a teacher of mine, I said, what could you see me doing? And he said, you would be great in communications or public relations. And so I looked it up, and it fit perfectly for me, and that was why I wanted to be an English teacher, is because I love speaking with people. It comes very naturally to me. And so I changed my whole decision for college and studied communications, which was such a great opportunity. Roger Williams University had a great public relations program, one of the best in the state. So I was exposed to many opportunities, got to do a lot of conferences, presenting on national panels, and got to see some great firms in Los Angeles, Boston, New York City, got to travel to DC. So was exposed to a wide array of opportunities because of the degree that I chose. So it was a great, great decision.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now what are you doing now? Are you?
Currently, aside from being Miss Rhode Island USA, I work full time. I'm the Deputy Chief of Staff for the Mayor of Providence,
Rhode
Island.
I know you are. I wanted you to say it, though.
Yeah. Yeah, and I'm very proud to say it, very honored.
How's a lawyer? We should get him on the show.
The mayor?
Yes. Yeah. I don't have many politicians on the show, although you heard my tirade at the beginning of the show. Every once in a while I go off, because my degree's in political science from Rhode Island.
Oh, awesome.
In fact, one of my professors, his name was Lee Verstandes. He was with the president right after I graduated. He mm-hmm. went to work for the then president of the United States.
Yeah.
That's a sharp, sharp guy.
Wow.
Yeah.
I actually, when I graduated Roger Williams University, I wanted nothing to do with politics. You know, some of my friends had asked me, what type of communications would you like to go into? Right. Do you want to do a firm, agency? And I always said, I'm not sure, but I know I don't want to do public affairs. I don't want to do government communications. And so I find myself entrenched in politics a couple of years later. But I really love what I do. I've always wanted to work in public service and give back to my community. And working full time in the mayor's office is an avenue for me to do that.
Sure, well, that's cool. That's good.
Yeah.
That's good. Mm-hmm. Now, you've done some traveling too in your time, right?
Besides
Portugal.
Yeah, aside from Portugal and France to see my godparents.
Did you like France?
I loved France. My dad actually lived in France for 9 years before coming to the United States.
Oh, wow.
So it was great going around Paris and seeing, you know, where he went to play soccer growing up, where his house was, and all of that stuff. So it was a great bonding experience for the two of us. But yeah, traveling is such an important part. I think it's so critical.
Oh, I think it's an education. I think it's the best education.
It's so critical to see and experience other cultures and know how good we have it here in the United States.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You go to some countries, and I've been in the bathroom in a beautiful house in Morocco, and I thought they were doing construction in the bathroom because all they had was a hole in the floor.
Yeah. There are some really difficult times going on around the world. And I love learning about cultures, learning about the new traditions, because I'm so involved in my culture.
Sure.
I studied abroad in Australia.
I love that. That's the only country,
continent
I haven't been to.
Yeah, beautiful continent, amazing laid-back culture.
Yes.
People are
laid-back
for me.
They love to party in Australia.
They do love to drink alcohol there, although.
Yeah,
that's all I'll say.
Their can of beer is not 12 ounces.
Yeah.
It's 26 ounces. That's the force of beer. 26 ounces of beer.
Yeah. But I had a great opportunity to go out to New Zealand and Fiji and the Great Barrier Reef while I was out there. So I got to really utilize my time and take advantage of the opportunity to be on the other hemisphere.
Wow.
Yeah.
Do the toilets flush the other way?
I don't know. I was told to look into that, and I never did.
Everybody asked that.
It's a quirky thing to ask, but you'd be surprised how many people want to know.
Now what's this about the Central Falls Alumni Association? What is that?
Yeah, I've been a board.
Your school? Your high school?
So, yeah, I graduated from Central Falls High School in 2009, and I believe in 2013 it was, we founded the Central Falls Alumni Association.
Right.
Basically with the goal of creating a culture of achievement through education in the city of Central Falls and providing opportunities to students through mentorship, through internships, and through scholarship opportunities to create opportunities of access for students to achieve a higher education degree. Growing up in Central Falls, I saw so many people, almost myself, not choose their dream school because of the financial needs.
Right.
And
Roger Williams is not a cheap school to go to.
Yeah, I pay off my school loans every month.
It took me seven years to pay mine.
Yeah, I mean, there are real expenses that come with going to school, and finances should never be a barrier for a student not getting to achieve their degree.
And you go around, you can check around. There are scholarships.
Yeah, so many scholarship opportunities. So we created a scholarship through the Alumni Association. We've had interns, we have numerous fundraisers with really just the goal of giving the attention that education deserves and providing students opportunities when you live in an urban city.
Right. Now what's with the blood donation? You like to give blood?
Yeah, I'm a very big
Oh my God,
blood
I hate
donation.
Needles!
No, it's so important. I have the universal donor. So I try to donate as regularly as I can, and I'll tell you why. When I was 14, my father was diagnosed with bile duct cancer.
Oh, God.
And when I was 16, there was a night when he was in the intensive care unit, and we were told by the doctors he wouldn't make it through the night because he was losing too much blood. And he had several blood transfusions that night, and he made it, despite the beliefs of the doctors.
Sure.
So, and he survived for another 2 weeks before losing his battle with cancer, but ever since then,
He's passed?
He has passed. Yeah, he passed away in 2008 to cancer.
Oh, sorry to hear that.
Thank you.
How old was he?
He was only 57.
Oh, God.
But I donate now because, you know, people who donated that night gave me 2 more weeks with my dad, so I donate now to give someone 2 weeks with their dad as well. So that's, I hate needles, but, you know,
thinking
about the importance and how much it's needed in this world, you know, with illnesses, accidents that happen, it's really important for people to donate when they can.
Mm. Well, that's difficult. Gosh.
Yeah.
You have a fundraiser Sunday. What's that? You got to get off that dad thing. Because I lost my dad when he was 36 years old.
Yeah, very difficult.
What's the fundraiser Sunday?
I was only 16. But I'm having a fundraiser this Sunday to raise funds for my Miss USA journey and to also raise money for pancreatic cancer in honor of my father. So 20% of whatever I make will be donated to the National Pancreatic Cancer Action Network. And so that's exciting to, you know, use my platform to raise awareness for a really scary illness that is in our country.
Sure, God. And how do people donate to that? How do they do that?
So they can go to my Miss Rhode Island USA Facebook and
which
all the information. It's Facebook, it's Miss Rhode Island USA.
Miss Rhode Island USA.
Yeah. And you can go to the event page right there and make a donation. And again, 20% of everything that I make will go straight to the National Pancreatic Cancer Network.
All right, so say it again. Miss Rhode Island USA.
Miss Rhode Island USA on Facebook if you would like to make a donation.
Well, we're going to go to the, you got to go to the karate thing?
I might.
Ocean State Grand National.
I might.
That's pretty cool.
I don't know if I could do karate. I could try. Not in high heels, though.
No, not in high heels. Not in high heels. No. That's awesome. He's awesome. Don Rodrigues is awesome. And you're awesome. You're going to take us out. We're just about done. Have you spent an hour with Bob?
I have.
Well, take us out of there. Sean,
sure.
McKenna.
Thank you.
And very nice seeing you, Miss Rhode Island.
Thank you so much. And nice being here.
Nice. You're very well spoken.
Thank you very
and
much.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
Take us out of here, Sean.
Sure.
And folks, thank you for spending an hour with Bob. You just go.
You met me on a Saturday night in late July.
We got it all in, right?
When I could believe in you, and you, me, and I could fly. Every time your blue eyes look my way. You had your doubts, and I had my chances. I don't ask why, but I could barely stand it. 'Cause I was someone else, I was breaking promises to myself, I was yours. A little while, so I thought, so I thought.
Thank you.